this f of a and compose it. So you're going to have a composition, not a product actually. Compose it with the Fréchet derivative of f at a actually.
So
delta is
G.
G has zero. Okay. G. There's no difference between G and delta. Is it making sense?
Yes.
So this is really analog to what you have done in one dimension. So what do you do in one dimension? So you have G composition f prime of A. So you say that, okay, compute the G prime and evaluate it f of A and multiply it with f prime of A. So now, what you have to do, compute the Fréchet derivative of G at B, where the B is f of A, times, not times, but composition. So that's a composition of the transformations actually, times the Fréchet derivative of f at A. Okay. Why you have composition here? Because think about it. If I not write anything here, then what is the meaning of multiplying two transformations? Does it make sense? So if there are transformations and you want to play with them, you have to compose them. So the composition only makes sense. So that would be the Fréchet derivative of the function at A. If I have two transformations, for example, so imagine P has a matrix P and you know S has a matrix say Q. So what would be the matrix of the transformation for the T composition S?
It's
so it must be Q. Okay. So the matrix of the transformation is not going to be PQ.
No.
So I'm saying that T is a transformation and this is the matrix representation of it. And S is a transformation and this is the matrix representation of it. What is the matrix representation of T composition S?
QP.
So it's going to be QP.
Yes.
QP.
Huh?
दूसरा कोर्स ले लिया दबाई का पड़ा है रोनी गया सो हेयर द थिंग सो व्हाट आर द मीनिंग ऑफ हैविंग अ मैट्रिक्स फॉर अ लीनियर ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन सो दिस मींस दैट इफ आई हैव टी एंड आई ऑपरेट इट ऑन टू द वेक्टर एक्स आई कैन गेट इट बाय मल्टीप्लाइंग पी बाय एक्स and S of X is Qx. So it would be T composition S operated onto X actually. T composition S, huh? So it's gonna be T of S of X. So T of S of X means
yeah, yeah.
Q means P. Okay, P. Am I doing something wrong?
P into Q of X.
Okay, so P S of X where P Q of X, huh?
Q
was
Q. You got
it? Yes. T. So S of X is what? So Q of X should be P Q actually. Okay, so it should be TQ. ठीक है, ठीक है. Now for Fréchet derivative, I know the matrix representation is what? The Jacobian of F evaluated at A. Okay. And I'm saying what would be, you know, the Jacobian matrix for G composition F operated on the A. So I know that this is same as the G of B times our composition D F of A. So the matrix representation of G composition F evaluated at A is going to be, you know, the matrix representation of G evaluated at B, so multiplied by the Jacobian of F evaluated at A, so by a simple difference relation. So if you want to find the Jacobian for the composition of the function at a point A, find the Jacobian of G at the point B times the Jacobian of F at A. We haven't yet talked about how to compute Jacobian directly. So the Jacobian is our key tool actually that will help us to compute the Fréchet derivative like crazy and quick actually. Are we happy with this?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Shall we do one example? So here's an example. So I have a map F from R2 to R that looks like F of X Y equal to sine X Y. Okay. F of x, y equal to sine x. So what I'm interested in computing the Fréchet derivative of F evaluated at a point A. Okay. I can compute it directly the way we like. One way would be that treat this as a composition of two functions. So which functions shall I take?
Sir, x, y, L, b, or a.
Take f
x, y
to be a map from R2 to R. That is doing what? It's taking f of x, y and giving you x, y. And take g as a map from R to R. Okay? And it's going to give you g of x equal sine. Okay, so if I want to compute, so I can see that f is basically nothing, it's just g composition f. Right? It's g composition. So if I want to compute the derivative of g composition f, in other words f, I need to compute the Fréchet derivative of b, so d g of b is going to be what? Okay, well b is, you have to remember b is f of a. So the f of a is f of a1, a2, and by definition this is a1, a2, right? So what would be the derivative of the g, Fréchet derivative? So g is a one-dimensional vector. So this is simple derivative actually. So it's simply g prime of the b actually. Okay? G prime of the b. So what would be the g prime of the b?
Cos x.
Okay? So you have cos b. How about for x, y? So you know it. So the df of a, say if I'm operating onto some h, so it's going to give me a1 h2 plus a2 h1, right? So this is what something that we have repeatedly done. And then what I need to do, what I just need to take the composition. So now I can write d f of a as what? As d g of b operated onto d f of a operated onto h. By the way, what does this composition mean? That if I am operating this guy onto h, so I'm operating this composition onto h actually. And by operating composition onto h, what do I mean? That take dg of b and operate it on df of a operated onto h. That's actually, right? This is what it means actually. Okay. So what is df of a h? D g of b df of a h is a1 h2 plus a2 h1, and d g of b is what?
Cos
a1 a2, just multiply with the cos a1 a2. Okay, maybe the only question that you can ask, what would be, so I'm treating this as a linear transformation actually. What would be the meaning of it operating onto some h? But you have to keep in view that since g is a map from R to R, this would be a map from R to R. So this would operate on a number actually. Okay, so it's going to operate on some k actually. And what would be the meaning of operating this function onto the k is simply multiply by the k. So in other words, the answer would be, so dg of b operated onto this means dg of b operated onto this, that's a scalar. Isn't that a scalar?
Yes.
Yes. The a1 h2 and a2 h1 is a scalar. So dg of b operating onto a scalar is cos b multiplied by the scalar. So just multiply cos b with the scalar and you get the derivative.
There is
going to
be a1, a2 plus a2, h1, sir.
Yes, you can. And if a is vector a1, a2 and h is vector h1, h2, their components are numbers, so that's a number actually. I'd like to finish this discussion with the last property, by proving the last property of the Fréchet derivative. So it has all those properties of the derivatives that we have seen previously, because it is the generalization of the previous derivative. The Fréchet derivative is the generalization. So it's not something that you are taking that to the new level actually. Okay? So I'm proving one property. You have lots of exercises in which you have to prove the other property. Okay. So now, when you will look at, I'll upload the second exercise sheet. When you will look at the second exercise sheet, you will see there will be lots of problems waiting for you to solve.
Sir,
okay?
So we have write exercise number one, but still there are a lot of questions within it.
Then why you are not telling me?
Sir,
that's what
so we have solved the worksheet, but some of the problems.
Okay, so what can I do is that I can upload the solutions today and you can have a look. I mean, if you still have problems, then you can come and discuss with me. Okay? So what about the basic properties that we have learned previously, that we have the Fréchet derivative of the sum of the functions. Okay. Equal to the Fréchet derivative of the sum. Fréchet derivative of the product of the function is the these two things together show that the pressure derivative is a linear transformation. So give me one of these and then I'll prove that I can do the first second. What would you like me to do? Mushkil wala hai. Interestingly, that's an easy one. So, good luck with the first and the last. All are easy to go. So, what I would like to show you?
Can we have question to you, sir?
Quotient root is product rule actually.
But it's reciprocal of something.
Quotient root is nothing. You don't need quotient rule actually. That's okay. Quotient rule is nothing. It's a version of a product rule. That would be a problem. Maybe. I mean, if you can find me the inverse, if the reciprocal of the function exists, then maybe you can talk about the quotient rule. If not, yes, that's the problem. So if I have a general graph from Rn to Rm, quotient rule will be a trouble. Because you need to divide by a vector, it doesn't make sense. Okay, so what I have to do, so I need to prove this. What these two things are,
They are two functions. Multinomial functions.
Okay, so they are two functions. So if they are functions, let me be precise, how to show the equality of the function? When two functions are equal?
When one is subset of one, another is subset of one.
When two functions are equal, so I know how to prove two sets are equal. How to prove that two functions are equal? So, in other words, for the domain, if they give you the same output for all, you know, then you're going to say that they are equal. So this is what that I would like to show. This is what that kind of something that you can do as well. Okay. Prove it in several ways. Okay. So let's take maybe. Let's take F1 and F2 as maps from Rn to Rn. Okay, so proving it for the simple case. And what would be the meaning of f1, f2 operated onto x? So it means that f of x, f1 of x, and f2 of x, okay? Take composition. If you have Rm to?
Rm, sir.
Rm. So f1 of x would be f1 of x would be a vector in Rm, and f2 of x would be a vector in Rm as well. Okay, so that's another problem. How to multiply a 1 by m vector with 1 by m, so would be, unless you put some dot product or something like that, unless you're doing the dot product, or maybe another. I mean, if you go into the notes, the other rule that it proves is for dot product. Right? If you have dot product of two functions, two vector functions, I think dot product would work for them. So you'll not talk about the product of two functions in this manner, but you'll talk about the dot product of them. So the dot product makes sense actually. Okay, so for the vector case, we'll do the dot product version of it.
Here we are multiplying simply because our output is just R, so they are numbers.
Yeah, they are numbers. Okay, so F1, F2 is a map from R. Okay? So what I want to do, the df1 of F2. And okay, so let's So I'm interested in computing d f1 f2 operated onto A and operated onto H, that how does this behave actually. So for that, what I need to do, I need to compute f1 f2 operated onto A plus H minus f1 f2 operated onto A. So that's what I have, from where I have to start. And I have to keep, you have to keep one thing in head, that f1 and f2 both differentiable. So that's what underlying assumption is basically. They are differentiable.
Yeah.
So their Fréchet derivative exists. So what would be the meaning of this? So it would be f1 of a plus h minus, or times f2 of a plus h minus f1 of a and f2 of a. Right? So can you guess something? So here's the thing. Any guess? So here's the trick. F1 of A plus H times F2 of A. So I'm subtracting it and adding it. F1 of A plus H times F2 of A and minus f1 of a times f2 of a, right? You see the trick what I'm doing, so that I can take my favorite common. So you're going to get f1 of a plus h times, you're going to have f1 of f2 of a plus h minus f2 of a and plus f2 of a times f1 of a plus h minus f1 of. Okay, you can already see we are getting in the shape. No, we are getting in shape. Getting in shape. So here's the thing. What should I do? I know this is equal to something, and this is equal to something. So this is f1 of a plus h times, I know this is what df of a operated onto h, which is my operator L, plus the error. Okay? Plus error. Okay. Let me call it E L2. And plus f2 of a, and this will be the differential of what? F1 of the f1 of a operating onto h plus error of f1 and maybe l1. So what I need to do now? I have to focus now that which of the numbers are candidates for the derivative and which numbers are candidates for the error. So the error must be sums of the error, and rest is the candidate for the derivative actually. Okay? So what I need to do? So Jari Bhat? So here's the thing. I'm defining L of H as f1 of a plus h times b, f2, f2 of a operating onto h plus f2 of a times b1 df1 operating onto h. So this is my the candidate for the derivative. Can you see it's already in the good shape? It's already in the good shape. So something that you like, D.
Yes, sir.
So F1, DF2.
Yes, yes.
F2, yes, DF1. You know, yes. We are getting somewhere. So I can say what now? So here's the conclusion. F of F1, F2 of A plus H minus f1 f2 of A, I'm bringing this L of H on other side, so it's going to be minus, equal to this E1 plus E2, you know, errors.
Yes, sir.
Okay? Take absolute, divide by norm. Divide by norm. And take limit. So this guy goes to zero because function is differentiable. Okay? And what L of H will become? So wherever you have H here, so that will go away actually. So what you're gonna get?
So
this will become, you know, as norm of it, because you have to take the limit on this side as well actually. So roughly you can say that the derivative that you have, so in other words, this will go away. Okay, A plus H will become, you know, what you call F1 of A actually. So that's it. That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. What else do you want? Thodi si hai. Thodi si hai. Halki hai.